Arrays are a way of storing a collection of data of the same type together. Let's say we need to store 5 integers. Rather than storing them individually as myint a, myint b, myint c, etc., we can store them in an array. We declare an array in a similar way to declaring an individual variable. However, after the type of the variable, we use open and closed square brackets. It's important to make the distinction that an array is not a type, but a collection of variables of a certain type. Before an array can be used, we need to know its length, i.e. how many elements will be stored in it. Elements are what we call items in an array. To specify the length, we use the new keyword, followed by the type of the array and the number of elements in square brackets. We can now initialize our array in the start function. We can access and initialize elements of the array by using the name of the array followed by square brackets containing the index of the element. The index of an element is simply an integer, with the first index being 0. When thinking of an element's index, think about how many steps away from the first element the one you're trying to access is. So to access the first element, use the index 0, since it's 0 steps away from the first. For the second element, use the index 1, and so on. Now I'm going to initialize the 5 elements in my array. So that's one way of declaring and initializing my array. However, if I want to, I can do it all in one line. This means that I can initialize my array at the same time as declaring it. We do this by using braces as we normally would for a function, loop, or if statement. Between the braces, we put the value for our elements in the order we'd like them to appear in the array. This will create an array of 5 ints just as before, starting with 12, then 76, and so on. Note that we didn't specifically state the length this time. This is defined by the number of elements within our curly braces. Arrays declared in this way can still be accessed in the same way as demonstrated in our first example, by using... There are a few things to note about arrays. If you make an array public, you will be able to see it in the inspector and allocate values to it. So if I save my script and switch back, I can see that where it's assigned to an object, my player's array is shown publicly in the inspector, and I can assign a length by using the size value. So if I type in a value of 1 into size, I get one element in my array onto which I can drop a game object, because that's the type of this array. However, we can use the script to initialize it. Unity has some functions that can help us to do this. We want our players array to store all of the players in our scene. The function findGameObjectsWithTag returns an array of all the game objects in the scene with a specified tag. Since our player game objects all have the player tag, we can pass this in and get all of the players in the scene. We can use the array that this function returns to initialize our new public players array. So simply by doing this, we have assigned everything that this function has returned to our players array. That means that it's collected the objects Aaron, Bob, and Charlie, as they all contain the tag player. Another great feature of arrays is that they work really well with loops. Let's say that we want to log the name of all of the players in our scene. We'll use a for loop to iterate through each element of the array. Arrays have a property for their length. This will return the number of elements in an array. This means that if we start our loop's iterator at 0 and continue to loop whilst it's less than the length of the array, we can perform a number of actions equal to the number of elements in our array. What's more, our iterator variable, I, will also be equal to the index number in our array. This will print out a sentence that says, player number 0 is named Aaron. It does this by taking the text player number, followed by the I variable representing the number or index, and finally it retrieves the player's name by looking at a particular index in the player's game object array. So I'll save my script and return. I'll press play, and here we can see that the for loop has logged 3 messages, one for each item in the array until it's reached the end of the array of elements. You can also see that the array is assigned to our public variable in the inspector, as it was initialized by the script.